You want to play?
That's what we do. Recession
okay.
Existing companies that pay dividends.
This is, we just started, so this is a test run. You guys ready?
Yeah,
I'm going to make a claim, and you move to whether you strongly agree, whatever. Here's the claim. Theocracy in the United States is better than secularism. Move.
Bureaucracy?
Theocracy. Secularism in the United States. Okay, what do we got? You say strongly agree. You say agree. You say slightly agree. Okay, why do you say strongly agree?
I would say strongly agree because it provides a central basis for collective rules and laws to be established. And if there's a ground for people to have differing opinions and views, it could be separation of church and state. But as far as culture goes, having a unifying presence is really important.
Okay. Now, he said slightly agree. Why do you think he said slightly agree and you said strongly agree?
Try to get in his brain. All right. Probably because he has more experiencing the actual state of the world from other cultural perspectives and backgrounds, and
which
there's
leads to
further understanding on how more diverse thought leads to easier collective.
Okay, he's struggling a bit. You tell him why you went to slightly agree and not strongly agree.
Because if we go to theocracy, we start giving up freedoms. So we need to have the freedom to practice different, but still have it. Now, do I believe that the Christian theocracy is the best way to government and for our country? Absolutely. But we also stand on freedom, so we have to have the other side.
Okay, now I said theocracy, and I wasn't specific. I'm going to change the claim slightly. I'm more interested to see if you move. Muslim theocracy, Sharia law, is better than secularism. You gonna move? Okay, now both of you shifted when I changed it from theocracy to Muslim theocracy. Why did you shift?
Because, the exact opposite of what I just said. Muslim theocracy takes away people's rights, and to me, it's a false religion.
Okay, now you're on disagree. But not strongly disagree.
Because I'm taking up the whole map.
Not because he's staying up. But do you want to go there or do you want to stay?
I'd probably say strongly disagree.
Okay, well. Same reasons as him?
Specifically because there is no options for freedom of speech to take place. It is one of the most limited worldviews to found a global community on. It works very well for their internal community, but once you start dealing with outside influence.
Okay, so you're saying Christian theocracy has a little more freedom than Muslim theocracy.
Absolutely.
Okay. Okay, new claim, completely different.
A lot more freedom.
Yeah. The freedom to be an atheist is a human right. Move. The freedom to be an atheist is a human right. You're struggling here.
Okay,
you say strongly agree.
Yes.
Why?
Well, you're free to make your choices, and if you want to choose atheism, you can. It may mean you're a degenerate or depraved, but you're free to be degenerate, depraved.
I'm an atheist, by the way.
I have nothing against you, but it's a closed-minded way. Atheism, you have no proof. You have no proof either way, and it's a choice, and you've made it.
Okay. Now, you said agree, but not strongly agree. You're different than these two guys.
Yep.
It seems like you're different on every question.
Yeah.
Why do you say agree and not strongly agree that being an atheist is a human right? Actually, you know what? I want you to predict his answer before he says it.
Why does he say agree and not strongly agree? What's holding him back, you think?
I have no idea.
Do you have any idea?
Nor I. You're asking me to guess what somebody thinks. I can't.
Okay. Well, empathy. Trying to get inside. Okay, what's your answer?
I don't know the guy.
The freedom to be an atheist is, I think everyone has the innate freedom to believe what they want about their life and have the freedom to think. But as far as it comes to God and as far as it comes to having a moral higher compass, you have a God no matter what. there, whatever your highest moral value is your God. And so to stand on atheism is a rocky point for anyone. And my it's more of a heart of empathy, like you're saying, and compassion, hoping someone could find a better answer than atheism, being that there is no ground for them to base their own self-construct off of.
Okay, we can have a great conversation about that later.
I guess that.
Honestly, it takes more faith to be an atheist than it does Christian.
It's a belief.
Okay. Oh, we got to talk about that later, too. Hey, here's the claim. New claim. You guys ready? Marksmanship ought to be taught in schools. That's the claim.
I got my foot on third base.
Okay, you guys all say strongly agree. Why do you say strongly agree?
Education's critical. Guns are dangerous. You need to know how to use them. They're a fundamental element of the American way. And the idea that the school system suppresses and censors information on firearms should be a crime.
Okay. You guys all agree with this?
I agree a lot of it, but I think the main reason is you need to have a comfort level with something that's so dangerous. A lot of the things, especially the accidents, is because they're not brought up and introduced to it. So it's like sex. If the parent doesn't teach them how to do it, they're going to learn from their friends, and it's usually disastrous.
Mm. Agree.
So coming from a family that's been in education for years, this wouldn't even be instituting a new phenomenon. We actually taught marksmanship for decades in this country, and we actually would only have to reinstitute the course curriculum. So it's not like it's a foreign concept at all. The other big element here is why did we stop teaching marksmanship in school? It's to take away the power for every individual in this community to have the equal ultimate authority to defend themselves, and everyone can come to the table and have equalization of power, which ensures equal conversation. Once everyone has the same level of the ability to defend their intellectual thoughts, all that's left to do is talk. And no matter your height, your weight, your religion, your skin, no matter your worldview, as long as everyone has the same amount of the same ability to defend themselves and bring power to the table, all that's left to do is speak.
Imagine someone giving the same claim standing there. What do you think their reason would be?
They don't understand it.
Ignorance.
So it's part ignorance, it's part fear of the unknown, and they get the media, the message coming from the left that it's a bad thing. And, you know, there's so many people that I brought to the range, and once they shot a gun, they enjoyed it.
But if a person was standing right there, do you think they would give that answer? I'm ignorant, that's why I'm standing there?
I would think so.
So try to imagine what they would actually say. What would be their concern?
I've had that answer many times. Guns are terrible and they're evil and they should take them away. Well, who is they? Them. They don't even know. They're hoplophobic. It's a medical condition. They don't understand it. They have an innate fear. It's based in ignorance, as my friend here said. They don't get it. And once you introduce them to firearms in a sane way, they ask for more ammo. And can I try that gun?
Okay. So it's fear-based.
And I'm a big proponent of women
having the gun rights and being concealed carry. Mm-hmm. Because without it, you're taking away their rights.
Okay.
Gun to train women. And it's insane the amount of college students from ASU. The second that they start practicing training, I've watched women come in timid, shaking, terrified to touch these firearms. They walk out, and I'm not even talking about the firearms. At this point, their shoulders are rounded.
Yep.
They're standing up tall. They're breathing easy. And they're going out to lunch, and I'll run into them on the street. And it's a completely different woman. She's actually more of who she innately is because she has an internal trust that in her ability to ward off any unwanted attacks, anyone else's undesired encroachment on her life, she now has the ability to stand up for herself. And
I like this guy.
You like him?
Oh, he's got it right.
Well, he like knows you. That's why you like him.
So let's see, you want to get something we don't agree on. I think they should eliminate concealed carry permits.
Yes.
Okay.
You agree?
100%.
Okay, let's, we'll do maybe one or two more.
Yes.
But let's go more controversial.
Yeah.
I'm going to make a claim.
Is Dallas Cowboys America's team?
Ready? Hell exists, and people will go there. That's the claim. Move.
What?
Hell exists, and people will go there. Okay, hey, this is getting better. We're getting some more diversity. Okay, hell exists and people will go there. We have a strongly agree, and a neutral. For once, we have some disparity. Okay, why do you say neutral?
I can't tell. Nobody can tell. You take this on faith. You could ask heaven the same way. Don't know, can't tell. You do it on faith. That's the answer.
Okay, Don over there said he strongly agrees that hell exists and people go there. Predict what, I know you hate doing this, but try to predict what his reason is.
It's a religious base. He was brought up to believe in heaven and hell. He thinks they're real. He was trained that way. He's justified it and found it true for him. And so he strongly agrees there's hell and he's going.
Okay, was Alan right? Is that your reason?
Somewhat. It's really, I mean, first of all, when you look at hell, we think about the burning and all that. That's not what I've learned or what hell is. No, hell is simply separation from God. The Bible talks about it being simply a gnashing of teeth. It's an opportunity you had and you gave it up. Somebody gave you a gift, you didn't take it. Jesus gave you a gift in eternity. Talking to you straightly now, straight. I mean, that's not a word. Okay. There's a gift that he's giving you. Okay. As humans, we can't be in the presence of God because he's perfect, but he has to be just. So what he does is he has Jesus pay the fine for our sins. All we have to do is accept that. And then you go to heaven. If you don't, you find out that the separation is not what you want.
So the separation is hell, not necessarily fire and...
Right. It's just separation from God.
Okay. Now, you said agree instead of strongly agree. It sounds like you have a little bit of doubt about hell.
I'll throw you a curveball here. I won't even keep a religious angle. If hell isn't real, why does LA glorify it? Why do all of the TV shows, movies, anthems, why are we constantly seeing depictions of hell as far as the commercialization version of it? If it isn't a real place that we have a real threat as a community, we have a bought-in belief that it's a real place and that people are going to go there.
Well, what if a person answers, well, there's tons of people who like Harry Potter and Harry Potter isn't real.
But do they still want to go to Hogwarts? Do they still want to go to...
Talk to my daughter.
do we still spend tons of money?
I went on the Hogwarts ride in Florida.
And so even if we take it out of the religious context, our society, atheist or Christian, there is a collective buy-in for the representation of hell that we see, and whether people go there or not, we'll find out, but we definitely believe that hell is real as a society, and this is crossing all worldviews and religions.
No, that's not true. Judaism doesn't actually hold to heaven and hell. And Judaism came first, Jesus was a Jew, and now they're saying, oh, there were no Jews in Israel. Come on, we're all going to celebrate Christmas.
True.
So
Alan's making a great point, like if hell's such an important thing to avoid, why don't the Jews talk about it in the Old Testament?
The Old Testament... Here we go. It's the only real thing. That was God speaking to humans, to Moses, on Mount Sinai. And those five books, that's it. Everything else is somebody who got a word, got a message, believed something. The Jews are still waiting for the Messiah.
Does what Alan's saying right now make you want to shift?
No. I know. Actually, one of the things he said was that hell, or maybe you said it, I don't know who just said it, but that hell is something you want to avoid. That's not the case. Who knows? Hell could be here on Earth. It could be, but it's what you're looking for is the fellowship with your Maker. And imagine you're with a buddy, and he says, hey, I'm going to go out with a party. You want to go out to a party? And you say, no. He goes out to the party. He has all these celebrities. He tells you about what a great time he's having. And now you're still okay, but you're missing out on what was really awesome.
Okay, so you're missing the party, is what hell could be. Okay, last one. This is probably the most controversial one. A man named Jesus was God in flesh 2,000 years ago and bodily rose from the dead. That's the claim. Move.
Can I go further?
Rose from the dead. Rose from the dead.
Bodily. A man named Jesus was God incarnate, died and rose bodily from the dead.
Gonna disagree on that one.
There you go. You finally got what you're looking for.
We finally got what I was looking for. Okay, you disagree. These two guys strongly agree. Why do you disagree?
Jesus was real, was very wise. He was a rabbi. He did a lot of good. Did he rise from the dead? I don't know. Nobody rises from the dead.
That's... If nobody rises from the dead, why are you on disagree instead of strongly disagree?
I'm a moderate.
Okay.
I'm going to have to run.
Okay, nice meeting you.
Well,
thanks.
I'm just going to run.
Now, I'm curious to know if your reasons to believe it are the same. So let's do it this way. You have 10 seconds to tell someone why you believe Jesus rose from the dead. Okay? What is the first thing that comes to your mind of your reason why you believe that? Who wants to go first? Got only 10 seconds.
Give me 20.
Okay, 20 seconds.
Okay, one, both secular and non-secular witnesses to the event of him rising. Two, you have 12 apostles or disciples who believed in him, believe they saw him rise from the dead. Either he did or he didn't. And if he didn't, then they all died except for one, believing in it and living that lie, that knowing that it was a lie. Or he did come back, they know he was, and they were willing to die for it.
Okay. Is there anything he said that you disagree with?
No, but I can build on it. There's a historical account of over 500 witnesses within a very short period after the rising giving account. So you have to either believe there was a mass hysteria, all recorded, in a time where recording was not a very popular or easily achievable feat. And the historical accounts that back this up have been proven dozens of times over. And more and more journalists, atheists, and other debunkers are trying to disprove the credits.
Okay, now we're going to do something fun, if you allow me.
Sure.
I'm going to move, and I want you to take, both of you to take turns taking the mic, and you ask me why I strongly disagree.
Okay.
Go for it.
About?
The claim.
Okay. All right. So, Doug.
Yeah.
Why do you believe that Jesus is not alive and he didn't rise from the dead?
Okay, because the evidence does not match the claim. So I'm gonna keep this very brief. If I told you my great ancestor flew unaided across the Grand Canyon and I ask you, do you believe me? You'd probably say no. So that's a huge claim that my ancestor flew unaided. Jesus, same thing. Now, do I think the evidence presented, like the 500 witnesses, we don't know their names. We don't know who they are. We actually don't have their own sworn testimony. All we have is a guy named Paul saying that 500 people saw.
No, there's non-secular.
Put the mic to you.
Oh, there's secular books and writings about the event. So you have people that didn't believe in him, but saw that he rose.
Okay.
The guard. It was one of the ones. The first question I'd ask you about your aunt that flew over the Grand Canyon was. Uncle, okay.
Grandfather, whatever.
Maybe he was transsexual, we don't know.
grandfather.
My first question was, who saw him?
Okay.
Okay?
Yep.
Two, if you told me that, and I said, are you willing to die on that? Literally.
Okay.
To believe it. But you know it's a lie. Okay. Are you going to carry that through to your death?
Okay.
Okay. Martyrdom is a great reason to believe in something if someone is willing to die. But I would make the claim that the only reason why people, Christians, know that some people died is because of traditions 50 to 100 years after. Nowhere in the Bible does it actually say that people died for their belief in the resurrection, except for maybe Stephen, and even Paul doesn't say. So the way Christians even know this is because of later traditions that's juxtaposed against other things that I'm quite sure you guys both don't believe. And so these are later traditions of people saying that they died for their belief in the resurrection. They could have died just because they were troublemakers, sedition.
Okay, can I ask you a question about atheism?
Yeah.
Okay, so you believe that it just happened. There's no creator.
What just happened?
Earth, everything.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
Is that what you believe?
I believe that it's a miracle we're here. That's one miracle I believe in.
Okay.
But to me, it is more reasonable to believe that the natural that all three of us agree exists. Supernatural, which is the realm that most people put God in, is a new category of existence that I just have no idea what it is. Like, to even define what the supernatural is without saying what it's not is next to impossible.
Okay.
And so, is it a miracle that we're here? Yes. Do I believe that something came out of nothing? No, I don't believe that. No, I don't believe in intelligence design. I think the natural has always existed just like God has always existed.
That if we're all animals, and there's nothing that separates us from the animal kingdom, there's no imago Dei. There's no.
You want to stand up there?
There's no imago Dei. There's no divine image. There's no separation, and we're just millions and millions of years of evolution. Why are you arguing for morals? Why are you curious in the debates? What? Let's switch it to a moralist argument.
Okay, we're going to shift from evolution to morality. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Got to do your job here. Why talk about morals? Because I have children, and I don't want them harmed. Just like you're probably too young to have kids. Just like you probably wouldn't want your children harmed. So there is much practical benefit to morality.
Okay. That doesn't serve evolutionarily.
No, you're right. You're right and wrong. Here's where you're wrong. Imagine us humans, 200,000 years ago, if you believe the Earth's that old, a society that works together, doesn't steal from each other, doesn't murder each other, especially the last one, is more likely to survive. And evolution's about survival.
So those are laws of the jungle. Why don't we see the laws of the jungle applied in school? Why are we developing a Judeo-Christian biblical moral hierarchy instead of law of the land? The fittest, the fastest, the most well-equipped should dominate and destroy the weakest, and we should not take any time to consider the weakest of the society. We should let them die off.
Okay, well, there's a balance, right? And one could argue, in a sense, our school system is survival of the fittest. Whoever gets the highest grades gets to go to the best schools. Whoever runs the fastest in track and field gets the gold medal.
That's how it used to be.
Whoever gets the highest grades gets the best spot in the factory based off of the Rockefeller structure. If we go back, and we go back to the school system, we want to switch gears here. We can go into this. The Rockefeller Foundation still funds the majority share of the public education system today, this year. And they were originally designed to produce factory-based workers and not create a society. So it was about production and means that it actually was law of the jungle. So are you saying that we should go back to culling off the weakest and rewarding the smartest, strongest that fit the models for the ruling class?
No, I do think that even in a society where you have this concept of survival of the fittest, which I'm not saying I'm 100% for, but I'm not denying its reality.
Great, actually. So how do we get there? From without Christ, without Christianity, without a moral hierarchy based on good and right on the Bible, how do we bridge this gap?
Great question. I would say it would be based on something like well-being, unnecessary suffering.
Awesome.
Now, am I against all suffering? No. I actually love to see my kids suffer a little bit because that's when they build moral character.
Great.
So I think you can get a moral framework from even trial and error. We do something. What does that do to society? Oh, that ruins. Okay, we're not going to do that anymore. Some things are obvious, like stealing people's property, murder, rape. Other things are not so obvious, like in vitro fertilization, good or bad. These are things that Jesus Christ never talked about in vitro fertilization.
Well, you're talking to the results of it, actually 20 years ago.
Really?
Yeah. So my
children are both test tube babies.
Fantastic. My mom got to see me and my twin.
You turned out okay?
Great. We turned out fantastic. Four cells big.
You've known for 15 minutes. Yeah, you might not.
True. Very true.
Could be Dexter on the other
end. Just flip the switch. But when we look at these kinds of questions, that's a lot of assumptions being made that we're breezing over, right? So right and wrong, what's good for your kids, what's bad for your kids, why should your kids have a chance without Christ, without a Judeo-Christian moral hierarchy, since it's evolution, right, since it's survival of the fittest, law of the jungle, how do we bridge that gap still to allowing our kids to suffer and having safety nets set up and protecting the weakest of society and allowing for people to have failures and not giving all the rewards to the upper class, going into socialism versus capitalism kind of.
I think that's a very difficult question. That you're basically asking what worldview is the best for society, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what you're asking. I think the United States is pretty close. I lean more capitalistic, but I do see the need for government assistance for certain people. My hierarchy is family first, then your neighbors,
right?
Then your community, then your state, and last of all, federal.
Right. Where'd you get that?
Probably the way I was raised.
Where did your parents get that?
Probably the way they were raised. They were Mennonites, and so it's like work or die, which getting back to survival of the fittest.
Yeah. That was like theirs, except they had one more level above.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
You guys like this?
This is an incredible experiment.
I love this stuff, yeah.
I think this is...
I'll come back and do this for you anytime.
Absolutely. I love that. I think this is how we further society, how we bridge gaps.
Yeah. The ability to talk from different points. And this, when I was younger, I'm dating myself, but that's the conversation was generally like this. We got into the point of, now I disagree with you, therefore you're bad.
Yeah.
You're evil. You're a bad person. And that's the identity that you become. You know.
Actually, jumping in on this too, growing up without a father, as a young man in today's society, I can speak for my peers, we don't have a lot of opportunity to watch the older generations debate and accept being wrong and change their opinions. And so the model isn't being set for us to be able to accept being wrong. It's a forced need to tribalize and make your tribal identity more valuable than your individual sovereignty and your individual opinions and thoughts, because you need that acceptance. And so as we go, thank you, both of you, for putting that opportunity out there for young men to actually get to watch and be a part of this, because this is where we really see healing happen for my peers and my generation.
Okay, thanks, guys. Thanks, guys.
Yep. Thank you.
Cheers.
We'll get some new people in here.
Still love you.
Still love
you. You know I'm an atheist.
Absolutely.
Yep.
God says I should.
That's great.
It's, you know, he doesn't say if you feel good about somebody, it's to love them.
Yeah.
It's a command.
Well, my wife's a born-again Christian, and I love her. She loves me. And we have great kids. And I actually think it, ironically enough, that difference. I was a Christian for many years, 35. That difference, like our kids see us differ in some of the major questions in life and still love each other. And so when they talk to their friends, they can actually understand you can disagree with someone without hating them.
Yep.
Or ostracizing them. So, thanks, guys.
You bet.
Yeah.